But first, Senate Republicans are turning to Washington after their Thanksgiving recess. And so far, their make or break week for passing tax reform is teetering on a tightrope. Montana Senator Steve Daines announcing that he's opposing the current form of the Senate tax bill, making him the second Republican to do so thus far. The senator telling Fox Business he cannot support the bill because it favors big corporations over small businesses, but he remains, quote, optimistic that he could support a bill if changes are made. Senate Republican leaders also announcing they could bring the bill to the floor as early as Thursday, as a possibility also of a government shutdown begins to loom. But do Senate Republican leaders have enough time to make all of these changes and convince their no vote colleagues to vote yes? Here to discuss, Heather Higgins, president and CEO of Independent Women's Voice, Ford O'Connell, Civic Forum PAC chairman and a Washington Examiner contributor, and Kaylee McEnany, an RNC spokeswoman. Kaylee, I'd like to start with you because you have a better feel for what's going on within the party, particularly with these folks who are on the fence, and how many Cornhusker kickback deals can be made between now and Thursday.
Well, Charles, I can assure you that there are going to be a large bevy of amendments that are going to come forward. The Senate bill you currently see is going to change. It's going to change for the better. I think this bill continually gets better. But these differences are not irreconcilable. I know the senators that you just cited who oppose the bill believe in free market principles. They believe in empowering the American people and keeping more of their wealth. And I'm hard-pressed to believe that they're going to show up and put their thumb down and drown out the idea of Americans keeping more of their money.
All right, Heather, you spent a lot of time in D.C. and New York, so you understand this as well as anyone else. People were hard-pressed to think Republicans would mess up Obamacare repeal and replace, but it did make it through on several attempts. So I'm not sure we should be so sanguine or so confident that this is going to make it through without some serious last-minute negotiations.
There will be serious last-minute negotiations. You're right about that, but I think most of them will go to improve the bill. The salient difference between Obamacare and this...
Tell me what's an improved bill.
An improved bill, I think, for example, Ron Johnson and Steve Daines, if they can take the pass-through rate from not only 40 to 32 where it is now, but move it into the 20s or even 30, that's helpful. If you get the $10,000 property tax exemption from the SALT, that will help a lot of the senators and or the congressmen in New York and right. others in California feel a little bit more comfortable with this. You've had a lot of maturity on the part of some of the senators like Rand Paul, who understands that this is not the last tax bill that's going to come down the pike. The really important difference between this and the health care bill is that after the health care bill, the Senate got to watch its donations go through the floor. And that has brought reality into right. their little calculations about, dear God, we must pass something or we will be in such hot water. So I think that Daines and Ron Johnson have made it very clear that they're not an implacable no. Even sure. Susan Collins hasn't said that, and Murkowski came around.
Right.
You've got, you know, McCain being the perpetual potential last-minute fly in the ointment, but I think that you are going to see this
right.
pass.
Of course, Ford, the problem here is this ointment doesn't have a lot of room for any more flies.
No, you can only lose two seats here. But let's state the obvious and the most positive sign thus far, and that is Kentucky Senator Rand Paul is an absolute yes. Now, here's where we have a real tug of war within the Republican Senate conference. It is between those who have mounting debt concerns about the overall package beyond the 10-year window and those like Daines and Johnson who want to make pass-through corporations, small businesses, 80-90% of all businesses in America more competitive with big corporations. I think Daines and Johnson have the right idea, and we're going to get there with them. The question with Flake, Corker, and McCain is very simple, is what kind of debt backstop could we possibly add in as amendment? And what that really means is if we are unable to achieve the revenues that we're saying we get, possibly we could have a mechanical function where the rates go back up for a period of time. So we're going to watch how this plays, but we're going to get there, and frankly, Charles, I'm far more optimistic with this than I was with Obamacare.
You know, Kaylee, Heather mentioned Republican fortunes, fundraising fortunes. Well, they have subsequently turned around. The coffers are full. There's zero debt. The party feeling really good, particularly the RNC. So it would seem that no one on the GOP side would really, truly, to your point, want to change this. But there's going to be some last-minute pressuring, right? There's going to be some pushing and pulling. And we heard about a week ago where perhaps the idea of the individual mandate could be scuttled to lure Susan Collins. I think that would be a mistake. I don't know how you find another $300 billion without that. So if you can, walk us through how this may ultimately look.
I think the individual mandate should stay. I know President Trump's a huge supporter of that because that begins the dismantling of Obamacare as well. But, you know, I think ultimately what you're going to see is, as Heather pointed out, maybe some changes on that SALT, the state and local taxation, perhaps some better benefits for small businesses. But I would just push back on this idea that Senators Johnson and Daines are putting forward that small businesses somehow don't benefit under this. That's not the case. This is the best rate that they've had in 80 years. So, you know, this is a good plan for small businesses. And I think every senator in Washington needs to step back right now and say, does this bill leave the American people better off tomorrow than they were yesterday without the bill? And the answer is undeniably yes.
So they absolutely are better off, to right. your point. It's just that they want to make them even better off than they otherwise would be. And, you know, to buy into the debt argument is to buy the CBO scoring model, which has always been wrong. And so I think it's time to give growth a chance. And it's really an argument between different perspectives on growth and prosperity versus sort of a stagnant, this is the best we can do, managing decline
right.
kind of mentality.
That's the static scoring versus dynamic scoring. But there's another element out there for it. I don't hear it a lot amongst Republicans, but you do in the mainstream media, and that's that this hurts the middle class, that some of the different scorings out there show that if you go further out, 2027, for instance, lower income folks, poor folks actually have a tax increase, and all the gains go to the upper echelon, the 1% and so forth. Is there any concern that could have an impact on this, even if the Republicans aren't talking about it outwardly?
No, I really don't think it's going to, because, look, at the end of the day, what President Trump promised is that the middle class is going to have a tax cut, and that essentially we're going to have better business growth. And if we are able to hit 5% GDP, Charles, everything that the media is talking about is bunk, because essentially they're using very liberal benchmarks in terms of what they perceive the GDP to be going forward. Because we all know that if everyone's paying more taxes because they have a heck of a lot more money, Charles, we're back in the boom times.
Yeah, we're actually on a cusp of a third consecutive quarter, 3%+ GDP growth or better. That headline is going to be absolutely amazing, Kaylee. I think it's going to happen. We keep seeing economic evidence of that. Beyond this tax bill, also looming large is the debt ceiling and the federal and government spending. How do you see those playing out? And could one of these things start to weigh on the other? In other words, you know, could you start seeing some horse trading with all three of these things?
Well, look, it all has to get done. We have a very busy month ahead. It's not Christmas yet. But what I worry about with the budget and the debt ceiling is Democrats, they are being the obstructionists that they once criticized. You recall they criticized Republicans for shutting down the government. And here are Democrats trying to tie the DREAM Act to the debt ceiling increase. That's absolutely hypocritical that the same folks once criticizing this tactic are now using it. But I think we'll get it done because we have to.
All right, Heather, are you as confident? It's a lot on their plate. Can they get it through? Because the clock is ticking.
Well, they don't have to get it all done before Christmas, but they have to get a lot of it done, and they will.
The debt ceiling is going to be okay?
I think so.
All right, guys, let's leave it there. Thank you all very much. Up next,
thank
President
you, Trump.
Trump spends Thanksgiving weekend blasting CNN and what he sees as fake news. We're going to have more on his latest attack when we come back.